broadcasting live 4 days a week worldwide
from the sunny beaches of Southern California.
This is ExtremeHealthRadio.com.
This is Drew Canole of FitLife.tv. You're listening to Justin and Kate of Extreme Health Radio. Remember, we're in this together.
Another Monday has rolled around, baby Kate.
I am baby Kate. Well, that's very fitting for today's topic.
That's true.
Babies.
That's true.
And birthing.
That's very, very true.
I know. Mondays have slowly crept up onto my my favorite day of the week.
I know.
I love Mondays.
I know. They're so great, aren't they?
Yeah, they're a gift. They used to be a drudgery, and now I look forward to them.
They used to be a complete drudgery.
Yes.
Yeah, we are very excited. We have Laura Shanley on the show. We're going to be talking about unassisted childbirth, which is going to be a very, very awesome topic to talk about. So I'm glad you guys are with us today. What's the day today here?
November 3rd.
November 3rd, 2014. And this is episode 338.
Mm-hmm.
338. Wow. We're just hauling along, aren't we?
Aren't we?
And if you guys would like to support our show, there's lots of different ways to do that. And we appreciate each and every single one of you that do support us. And you can do that making all of your holiday shopping or any time of a type of shopping you want to do through our Amazon link. And it's a free way to do that. So if you want to go to extremehealthradio.com/Amazon and bookmark that link and use that link every single time you make a purchase about anything. Doesn't have to be health related. That helps keep the show free for everybody. So we really appreciate that. And I want to let you know that this particular show is brought to you by the Bellicon Rebounder. And that is our favorite piece of exercise equipment on the planet. It's an amazing thing, and it helps. It's a cellular exercise, so it stimulates every single cell in your body. It's great for bone density and building bone density. And it cleanses out your lymphatic system, which is very, very important for...
What doesn't it do?
Anti-cancer and all kinds of great stuff. So if you want to get $30 off during the fall season, go to extremehealthradio.com/Bellicon. You can check that out. We broadcast live 2 days a week now. We're down to 2 days because we've got some special projects going on. So 2 days a week, 9 a.m. Pacific time at extremehealthradio.com/live on Monday and Friday. So you can check those out if you're interested in joining the chat room and making some friends in the chat room. And today we have Laura Shanley on the show. Very excited about having her on. I've known about her work for a long time. And she's a freelance writer, a birth consultant, speaker, and she's author of the book Unassisted Childbirth. And she's also the mother of four children, and all four of her children were born at home without the help of doctors, and get this, or even midwives.
Oh my gosh.
So no doctors, no midwives. And she's very interested in how the mind affects the body and how she can help coach women to be able to do this. And so very fascinating idea. And I think our culture has sadly turned the birthing process into a medical trauma issue.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's, I think, very timely to have Laura on. So thank you so much, Laura, for being on the show today.
Sure. Glad to be here.
Yeah, so glad. I've known about your work for a long time. And for those that don't know, your website, just want to make sure we get that out there a few times during the show, is freebirth.com. Is that correct?
Yeah, freebirth.com, unassistedchildbirth.com. Either one will get you there.
Awesome, awesome, awesome. And so how long have you been interested in, what got you originally interested in this this whole idea?
I got interested in this... before I go on, I can hear everything, like, after it's, like, I'm hearing everything being repeated.
Oh,
so are you getting, do you happen to have the live show page open on your
No.
computer?
Oh, maybe I do. I wonder if I do. Let's see.
Oh, man.
I forget to do that, too.
Okay. You're right. I opened it a few days ago, and I forgot it was up there. Okay. Oh, this is much better.
Oh, good. We've done that before, too.
I do that all the time, so no big deal.
Okay.
Nice.
Yeah, I'm not all that technically savvy.
I'm not either.
Okay, but I did know how to turn that off. Okay, so I got interested in this. I met my husband-to-be, and now my former husband, when I was 18, and he had become interested in birth trauma, and he had just finished reading Childbirth Without Fear by Grantley Dickreed, and who was an early natural childbirth advocate, and sort of considered by many to be the father of the natural childbirth movement, English writer. And Childbirth Without Fear, the book just fascinated him, and he gave it to me the night that we met. He's like, you got to take a look at this. And,
wow.
And he felt that that so many of our problems stem back to birth, that birth for most women in this culture is very traumatic, and it sort of sets the tone for future experiences. Like, you know, it's traumatic for the mother, it's traumatic for the baby, and then it you sort of get it in your mind that, yeah, life is painful and problematic. And so Grantley Dickreed believed that actually childbirth should give a woman a feeling of exaltation. It shouldn't be the worst, the most painful, horrible thing she ever goes through, but that basically our fear causes us to produce stress hormones, which essentially shut down labor, and so then babies get stuck, and mothers are in agony, and then babies are traumatized. And so he felt that if women could overcome their fear of birth and realize that it's a natural process, and our bodies have been well designed, and this is actually supposed to produce a feeling of ecstasy, that that many of our problems that we have in life would vanish, because we'd start off on a positive note. And so this really intrigued David, and so he gave me the book, and I really had not had any maternal feelings up until then. I had heard about childbirth, you know, in the media, family, and I just thought, no, this is not something I ever want to go through. And so I began reading the book, and literally I could feel maternal feelings start to surface in me. And I don't know, for some reason I just took right to it. And then at the time I was also reading books about the power of thoughts and feelings. I was reading the Seth material by Jane Roberts, and it just talks about how you create your own reality. And so I thought, okay, I mean, David and I ended up becoming a couple, and the more we looked into birth, the more we thought, well, why, you know, if we create our own reality, then let's create an easy and safe birth. And if we bring in someone else, even a midwife, we're going to have to explain all this to them. And so David said, let's just do it ourselves. And so we were at that time also just super optimistic. I mean, I'm still an optimistic person, but I guess I thought at that time, like, you know, I mean, I can create anything, which I know I can, but I didn't realize that maybe I had, you know, there were going to be some more obstacles along the way, that maybe it wasn't quite as easy as I thought it was going to be just to create whatever I wanted. And so, because I now understand that you can have limiting beliefs that can get in your way, but we just decided, okay, we're just going to do it ourselves. I read Spiritual Midwifery. I came across that book by Ina May Gaskin, and that also helped me a lot to understand that, you know, basically it's just a matter of allowing your body to work the way it was designed.
That's so interesting. So what did your friends and family think? They think you're crazy?
Yes.
Yeah. Wow.
So my father was a physician. My mother did medical research. My sister was a labor and delivery nurse. So I came from a very medical family. So to say to them, and I was a college student, and suddenly, you know, we're having a baby, and my family was not at all happy. I mean, they were pretty much terrified when I said, you know, I'm pregnant. I mean, basically, I didn't tell my parents I was pregnant until I was 7 months along, because and they lived like half an hour from me, and I saw them when I was 6 months pregnant, and they were like, "Oh, it's too bad you've gained weight." It's just the way I kind of carried. I didn't look pregnant.
Wow.
Oh my gosh.
And I just looked sort of fat. And so I basically sprung it on them all at once. Like, I'm pregnant, I'm having this baby, and we're doing it at home by ourselves.
Oh my goodness.
So it was a lot to handle. And so, but I just felt like, you know, I knew, I mean, I told a few friends, but we were kind of solitary people. And so, you know, I did have a couple friends that were supportive. My ex-boyfriend has, and his new boyfriend had decided, said they wanted to come to the birth. And we had another friend that wanted to come to the birth. So, and we had a filmmaker, who somebody who was at the college, who taught at the college. I was at the University of Colorado. And he wanted to make a film about us. He thought this was really interesting. So we did have a, you know, a little bit of support. And so, you know, it was basically at the birth, it was me and five men. So it was very unusual.
Yeah.
And, but yeah, you know, anybody else that I mentioned it to reacted very negatively. So I'd say if I was a solitary person before all this, I became even more solitary, because it's just, you know, you don't want to have to defend your choices, and people don't, so many people don't understand. They don't understand that, you know, they think that birth is inherently painful, traumatic, dangerous. And so, and they believe, you know, there's so much misinformation out there. People think that women and babies were dying left and right before the advent of modern day hospitals. And, you know, I can go into that. I mean, I don't want to get too off topic, because I know you asked me a question, which I can't even remember now. Oh, how did people react?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. And so anyhow, yeah, in answer to that, yeah, I didn't really have much positive response.
I can imagine. And do you find yourself even today when you talk about it with people, or especially during that time, that because you had done a lot of work on yourself, obviously, emotionally, and reading a lot of books and really doing some... probably some meditation and
deep spiritual work.
Deep spiritual work.
Like, yeah.
It seems as if, because I watched an interview on your website where you were being interviewed by a couple newscasters. It looked like you were in a studio.
Right.
And they
right.
were just so shocked and so surprised at the things that you were saying. And it just struck me as something that people that don't do that work, and people who sort of take hook, line, and sinker everything that the medical industry tells them or the media tells them, are just very, very adverse to this type of thinking, and they're very shocked by the things you're saying. But I'm sure you find that when you talk with people who do spiritual work and they aren't shocked, I bet you find that refreshing. And that could be one of the reasons why they're not shocked.
Right. I mean, you know, what actually has surprised me is that even when I have talked to people in the spiritual world, I even get shock there. Like, even people who say, oh, you create your own reality. But when it comes to childbirth, it's like I've even gotten criticism from them. And I've had people say, well, yes, you know, I create my own reality, so I believe that I have the best doctor out there. You know, it's like, well, wait a minute. You know, go kind of pull back a little bit, because, you know, if you truly create your own reality, then why do you need a doctor? Well, because, you know, you never know what could happen. Or so I think these things are, these concepts that birth is inherently dangerous are so ingrained in people's minds that even people who do believe that they are powerful, they still tend to go to the medical profession. I mean, I think that's little by little that's changing, and I do think it's going to change more. But yeah, I'd say now there are more people now that are open to this than when I first, you know, because my oldest is 36. So, you know, things have, I mean, back then when you talked about you create your own reality, or like, you know, now you can talk about the law of attraction, that, you know, that I'm really fascinated by the Abraham Hicks material, and there's a lot more people into that. So yes, these concepts are getting out there, and so there are people that are looking into it more. And I just think, you know, the world is changing and evolving, and to me, this is just part of, you know, people are taking responsibility for their own lives and not so much going to doctors and saying, well, doctor knows best, you know, whatever you say, doctor. Well,
right. Absolutely. In your findings, Laura, I don't know whether research or just, you know, books you've read and things, do you think the majority of women throughout the ages have been basically doing this themselves or with their partner? Or do you think that they've, most of them have had women surrounding them that have kind of gone through it before? Or do you think it's mostly like, I don't know, I'm thinking of like pioneer days. Do you think these women were all by themselves? Or what do you think the majority of women were birthing? What were their stories, do you think?
Well, there's a good book by Judith Goldsmith called Childbirth Wisdom from the World's Oldest Societies. It's out of print, but you can get it, you know, used online. And she says that, you know, when you talk to midwives, midwives will say, well, midwifery is the oldest profession and women throughout history have had midwives. And what Judith Goldsmith says is that Westerners would go into these tribal cultures and they would see a woman maybe helping with a birth and they would assume that she was a midwife. But really, most of the time, she was just the woman's mother or mother-in-law, and she may not have really had any special knowledge. So over the years, then midwives did sort of evolve, and then there were women in the tribe that knew a little bit more about it, and they did sort of start kind of coming in. But I'd say, you know, throughout most of history, it was just, you know, the women doing it themselves or with a mother or maybe a partner. And and in some of these tribal cultures, you know, the problem with a lot of these tribal cultures is that a lot of them have sort of strange beliefs. So even though they may not have the outside interference from the doctors and all, even though they may be doing it themselves, they still may have problems because babies are being taken away from mothers right after the birth because they believe that the colostrum in a woman's breast that is there right, you know, when she gives birth, that's bad for babies. And so I'm not putting tribal birth up as like, oh, you know, this is perfect. No, it had its problems too. But,
absolutely.
But yes, I think the unassisted childbirth really is more the norm throughout history. I think what makes it different now is that we don't have to have these strange tribal practices. So we can have all the good that happened in the past of women not having other people interfering, but we can also not have the strange tribal practices that sometimes made birth more dangerous.
That's really neat. That's like the best of all worlds. And there is something really cool about being in this time and space. But
I was wondering, Laura, are there people that you would consider to be not good candidates for doing a home birth like this? Because, you know, I've heard different people say things like for example, with the MMA world, with the mixed martial arts world, I've heard people say, because I used to train a while back, and people would sort of dabble with that kind of, you know, should I do MMA or should I not? And it's such an extreme sport that if you're not sort of living it, eating it, breathing it, and drinking it all day long, you're going to go in there and get just crushed. And I'm wondering if there are women out there that sort of want to do this, but they're not
fully committed,
entrenched. And I'm wondering if there are any types of women that you would say, you know what, it might be better for you not to do this.
Well, I would never make that decision for anybody. And I do get people writing to me, do you think I'm a good candidate? And really, you know, people, it's absolutely something they need to make, you know, that decision for themselves. But I will say that over the years, when people have had problems, if you look at the people who have had problems, it's generally people who are on the fence. They believe it, but they don't believe it. They're going to do it unassisted, but they also are going to a doctor for prenatal care just in case. Like, they're just sort of back and forth. And so, it's not that I feel like this is, you mentioned like, okay, an extreme sport. There are people that have compared unassisted childbirth to extreme sports. Like, this is, you know, way out there. To me, this is like so natural and so normal, and so easy, really, when you grasp these concepts. I mean, my last baby, my husband was down the hall. I hadn't told him I was in labor. And then I just birthed her into my hands because I was just so relaxed and I didn't even realize that she was going to come that quickly.
Oh my gosh.
And, you know, I went to take a bath and she slid into my hands, and then he heard her cry and he, like, you know,
came running
down the hall, and he, like, I saw his jaw drop just because I hadn't said I'm in labor. So I really think that it can be so extremely easy when you get out of your own way and other people don't get in the way. But doubt and fear is powerful. So I think if you are terrified, then birth can be problematic for you wherever you are. So, but I think, you know, and I've certainly seen women who have had unassisted births that have, I've seen women who have been obese who have done it fine. I've seen women, I knew a woman who gained 10 pounds with her pregnancy, and she had a 6-pound baby. You know, most people would think she was just way too thin. She did fine. I know women who've had all kinds of, you know, bled through pregnancy or had other issues. You know, I had a footling breech baby. So I think those are the kinds of things that probably some people would say, oh, well, then you wouldn't be a good candidate for unassisted childbirth. And I would say, well, that's not necessarily true, but you could be super fit and eat all the so-called right foods. And if you really have not dealt with your beliefs and kind of looked at, you know, your, if you had maybe examined your beliefs to see if you sort of have conflicting beliefs, if you have issues, if you have a lot of sexual shame or a lot of guilt, you know, these things. So I think it's the emotional aspects. That's what really comes into play. And so if you are really very doubtful and this really frightens you, then maybe, you know, there are some women that would say they pushed through their fear and they did fine, and other women that may end up having problems. So it just, I encourage women when they write to me, I just say, you know, this is a decision that you need to make for yourself, and look within yourself and see what really makes you comfortable. And when you imagine your birth, you know, pay attention to how your body is feeling. If you imagine your birth and you imagine yourself giving birth unassisted, do you feel a tightness in your chest? Do you feel that kind of feeling in your stomach of, you know, which it, like it's sort of that adrenaline, where, you know, you can kind of tell if this makes you really uncomfortable, then that doesn't necessarily mean don't do it, but it means you've got some inner work to do.
Mm.
Yeah, fascinating
stuff.
We're going to take a little bit of a break right now, but when we come back, I'm curious, because you do a lot of work and you're very interested in emotions and fear and things like that. And so when we come back, I'm just thinking about the women out there who this resonates with, but they've been programmed through media and through medical commercials and things they can do to overcome their fears and okay, what to stay away from and things like that. Mm-hmm. So this is really great information. Laura Shanley, if you want to visit her website is freebirth.com. FreeBirth, freebirth.com.
On there right now. It's just beautiful.
Yeah, it's awesome stuff. And she's also the author of the book Unassisted Childbirth. So you can check that out on Amazon or wherever you like. And this is episode 338, and we'll be right back with Laura right after this break. If you are currently using any hair care products that contain dyes or colorings, these things can be carcinogenic. You see, anything we put on our skin, even in the shower, gets into our bloodstream and causes a toxic overload to our organs over time. That's why we only recommend Morocco Method hair care products, because they're 100% chemical free, 100% organic, raw, vegan, and even wild crafted and picked according to the lunar cycles. Listen to what our guest Anthony Morocco says about foaming agents in the shampoos.
Well, number one with hair care is the sodium lauryl sulfate, which is a foaming agent, which is really carcinogenic, and it's very, very toxic. So that's number one. And so they're so afraid of it, the industry has made 38 different names for it. They've created cocamide, they've created coconut, they've created palm oil. But anything that foams is sodium lauryl sulfate. So I would say that you really need to read your ingredient lists And if you cannot pronounce the word, it's made in the laboratory.
So would even organic hair care products that foam, would those be damaging as well?
Yes. Organic really today is not what it used to be. So it's just the word. It really, to me, is not reality. If you want a real product, you want to look at Wild Craft.
As a former hairstylist, I love Anthony's products. If you'd like to have truly healthy and luxurious hair, no matter what your texture, go to extremehealthradio.com/MM for Morocco Method or see it in our store. Again, that's extremehealthradio.com/MM to learn even more.
Would you like to feel more energy and a better sense of well-being? What's flowing through your blood makes all the difference. In my 22 years of nutritional practice, I've found that the food and supplements taken into the body determines to a large degree the amount of energy and happiness people have. One giant step in the direction of more energy and happiness is the type and quantity of protein you consume. 2 years ago, I was introduced to a whey protein powder that gave me more energy and a better sense of well-being. Having struggled with low energy, this was a welcome experience. This protein is called One World Whey. It is the first ever undamaged whey protein powder from grass-fed cows. People report the following: profound improvements in blood sugar and energy, elimination of pain, better bowel movements, detoxification, younger-looking skin and fat loss. Athletes love the strength and endurance-producing effects. Call 888-988-3325. That's 888-988-3325. Or visit oneworldway.com. That's oneworldwhey.com.
And in my opinion, this is the best raw grass-fed protein powder on the market. It's developed on Amish farms. It's got 25 grams of protein in each single scoop. Crazy amount of protein. Increases your glutathione levels. It helps to release heavy metals and toxins, decreases inflammation all throughout the body, especially in the gut. And not only that, but it helps you build muscle and increase energy as well. It has tons of anti-aging properties. So really, really great protein powder. We like to use it every day in our smoothies. And our resident cancer guru, Ty Bollinger, what do you think about One World Whey?
Over the commercial there, you're talking about One World Whey. I want to encourage anybody that's listening, go to their website, go to Justin Cate's website and buy the One World Whey. That's something that we include every day in our diet. Every lunch, we have a One World Whey smoothie with super greens mixed in with it. It is fantastic. It's the best protein you're going to get. And as they mentioned, it's from grass-fed cows. It's organic. It's cold pressed. I mean, it is, you're going to get huge nutritive values from this One World Whey. It's the best protein on the market, I think. So then that's something that most people are deficient in is quality protein. So I highly recommend you go there and go to their website and buy this stuff. It's the best that's on the market. And I'm good friends with Stephen Hewer, who is the owner of Synergistic Nutrition. And he's a quality guy and they have excellent customer service as well.
Yeah, he's an amazing guy. We interviewed him on episode 88, and he's just an amazing guy, and I really love what he's doing. That's why I love supporting his work and love taking his products as well.
Yeah, great stuff.
And if you'd like to support Extreme Health Radio and the work that Kate and I do, you can get your hands on this One World Whey protein powder that I love so much at extremehealthradio.com/whey. That's W-H-E-Y. Or you could check it out in our store as well. That's extremehealthradio.com/way.
100% listener supported. Extreme Health Radio. Opening minds and transforming lives worldwide. Don't forget to join our thriving community for health tips, inspiration, and show updates at extremehealthradio.com/Facebook.
I'm a little late coming back onto the show because I'm typing to Colin in the chat room talking about our upcoming interview with Dr. Joe Dispenza coming up about the placebo effect.
Right, that's a week from this Thursday.
Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Is that week from, it's not, oh yeah, it's not this week, next week, right?
Right.
Yeah, so that's going to be a good show.
The placebo effect, yes.
Yes, yes,
very
yes.
Good stuff.
Well, we're having a great time here with Laura Shanley, and I'm just really excited about the work that she's doing. I think that it's really just important work to have out there in the world today. This is episode 338, is that right?
Correct.
Okay, 338. And if you want to check out any of the books that she's mentioned or the show notes, you can go to extremehealthradio.com/338. And if you have any questions about those particular products that we just ran commercials for, the Morocco Method and the One World Way, two of our absolute favorite products, you can always email us and ask us. And don't forget to go over and check out those if you're interested in them. We do broadcast live 2 days a week on Monday and Friday at 9 a.m. Pacific at extremehealthradio.com/live. And Laura, before the break, we were talking a little bit about fear and how fear plays a role, perhaps programming from the media. And I was just wondering if you had any tips for women who are interested in doing this type of birth, what they could do in order to overcome the fear, things they should avoid and perhaps things they should start implementing into their life.
Okay. Okay. Now, for some reason, I'm getting that echo again.
Uh-oh. Oh, no.
Are you? Okay. Let me see here. Turn down the old volume there. And are you still getting the echo?
No. Is that yes, I get it when I talk a little bit. Okay, I think it's better.
If we ever have to, I can always just call you right back on Skype, so it's no big deal.
Yeah, I think it's okay.
Awesome.
Yeah, okay. So what can women do? Well, basically, I tell women what helped me because I think I'm pretty typical. So, you know, what helped me, first of all, was reading Childbirth Without Fear, and I'll just briefly explain because I can do it in like under a minute, I think, what he says fear does. And essentially, when you're afraid, you trigger the fight-flight response, and you're telling your body it's in a dangerous situation, and so your body produces adrenaline and noradrenaline, and it's what it's trying to help you do is get out of this dangerous situation. So it stops the flow of blood to the uterus. It stops the flow of blood to the face, which is why you turn white when you're afraid, and it sends the blood and oxygen into your arms and legs so you can fight the danger or run from it. So what happens when a woman is afraid in labor is that what Grantley Dickreed says is that the uterus of a woman in labor, a frightened woman in labor, it's literally white. It doesn't have the fuel it needs, so that's why the contractions become painful, and waste products can't be carried away. So, to me, it was a big relief to understand physiologically, this makes sense. That, you know, because you hear, okay, childbirth is painful. Well, why? You know, sex feels good because we're supposed to procreate, you know, I mean, and so why then would birth be this excruciating, dangerous thing? Well, it makes much more sense that, no, your body is trying to help you. It's like, oh, you're in danger? Don't give birth now. It does the same thing if you are in a state of fear. Blood and oxygen don't go to your digestive organs. So that's why you might get a stomach ache. You know, if you're always tense and nervous because your digestive organs are literally shutting down, that's why if you have to get up and give a speech and suddenly your mouth gets dry, it's because saliva production is like the first step in the digestive process. And so you've just told your body danger. So your body thinks, oh, I don't need to produce saliva right now. I need to send the blood and oxygen into the arms and legs so I can run away or fight this danger. So to me, understanding that if I can calm down, then blood and oxygen will naturally flow to my uterus and it can gently contract and get my baby out. That really appealed to my rational, critical mind. So that was like, I wasn't even that spiritual at first. I grew up basically being an atheist. So the rational, critical, to help dispel those fears, to see that childbirth is not inherently dangerous or painful, that really helped me. So, and then reading about birth throughout history, and that what Judith Goldsmith says in Childbirth Wisdom from the World's Oldest Societies is that anthropologists went in and studied tribal cultures and lived with tribal cultures, and many of them, or most of them, reported that they could live with a tribe for years and never see a death or a complication in birth. So it really is a myth that women and babies were always dying. So if people can understand that they're in healthy tribal cultures where the women were well-fed and treated well, that women and babies were not dying and were not having all these complications. So that understanding those facts, I think, can be very helpful. The next thing I tell women to do is go read birth stories. And I actually, my site was hacked last year, and I still am in the process of sort of putting it all back together. It ended up to be kind of a technical mess. And so I still have a lot of birth stories on my site, but I'd say in the next couple months, I'm going to have more. And reading positive birth stories, I kind of wanted my site to be sort of like the Disneyland of sites. I mean, I wanted it to be a place where people could go and just read all this fun, positive stuff about birth, you know, articles that were just really reassuring. I had an article, I think I still have it on there, I'm not sure if I put that one back up, but Childbirth Ecstasy, where I just had quotes from women, and not even all women talking necessarily about unassisted birth, but just a birth that they felt just brought them a feeling of ecstasy. My site actually began because I was going to write another book called Labors of Love, a collection of pleasurable birth stories, which I didn't end up doing, but I started collecting stories from women who felt their births had been profoundly pleasurable, painless, psychic, spiritual, or sexual. And so I gathered all these stories, and I said they didn't have to be unassisted. Well, it turned out that nearly all of them were, because if you're having these pleasurable feelings or sexual feelings, or you're not really in pain, then a lot of these women didn't realize, oh, the baby is going to be here any second. And so they did end up being unassisted. But I think reading positive birth stories, and I know some people say, you know, you got to have a balanced approach, and you got to read about all the things that can go wrong. Well, that's not the way I did it. And that's not really, I think if someone really wants to go out there and read about all the things that can go wrong, then go for it. But to me, things are, when you block that energy because of fear and shame and guilt, it can come out in a myriad of ways. It can come out with the baby being stuck. It can come out with the placenta never, you know, not coming out, or it can manifest in many different ways. And so to me, you can go out there and you can read about, well, how do I deal with this and how do I deal with that? Or you can kind of pull back and look at why are these things happening and look at the psychological reason behind these things and then address that. And so that's the approach that I've taken, and that's kind of what I encourage people to do, is if you can deal with, you know, the emotional issues behind it, then they won't manifest in these things. Mm-hmm. But anyhow, so I said, you know, I tell people, read positive birth stories, go look at videos. There's so many videos out there, and I do think that the unassisted birth videos, to me, are the best ones to watch, because even if you're not planning an unassisted birth, it still is good to see someone who does it and who doesn't have someone interfering. And even now, I look at, say, books like Spiritual Midwifery, or I look at videos of women giving birth with midwives, and I was like, No, they don't need to be in there doing that. They don't need to be checking dilation. They don't need to be telling a woman to get into a different position. I truly feel that there is a, you know, everyone has inner guidance, just like the cat knows how to birth kittens, that inner guidance will be there if you just allow it to be, if you allow yourself to access that information. Look to your dreams. I practiced giving birth in dreams. And at the beginning of my first pregnancy, I was dreaming that my dad was there and other doctors, and I was in pain. And by the end of my pregnancy, I was dreaming that it was just babies just falling right out. Mm-hmm. So practice giving birth in your dreams. You know, suggest to yourself that you'll practice that. Mm-hmm. Affirmations, belief suggestions, I use those. I told myself, you know, I believe I give birth easily, and I trust my body. I love myself. I believe in myself. It's really a matter of learning how to do nothing. I look at birth as, I compare it to going to sleep, going to the bathroom, having sex. You know, what do you do when you want to go to sleep? You need the room to be quiet and dark. You know, just so there's no, I mean, you don't necessarily need a dark room for birth, but, you know, you need that peace. You need, if everything is around you making noises, it's hard to just relax and go into that, you know, that slip into that consciousness, that level of consciousness that you need to go to sleep. And same thing with birth. So it's like, oh, how do I go to sleep? How do I produce all the chemicals that I need in order to go to sleep? Well, you basically just don't interfere. If you lie there and you're in anxiety about what about tomorrow? What about this problem in my life? You know, then you're going to be producing adrenaline and noradrenaline, because here again, you've told your body you're in a dangerous situation. So your body is literally trying to keep you awake, because you're telling it there, here are things that need to be dealt with right now. And so your body thinks it's doing you a favor. So I guess I tend to kind of wander here, but yeah, so, affirmations, belief suggestions. And I didn't go crazy with this. I've seen some people that try so hard and think they have to do all these things, you know, and I hired a massage therapist, and I hired, you know, a midwife and a doula. And I knew, someone who actually hired a comedian, you know, it's like to come to her birth. And actually I do have an article called Laughter and Labor. Like, it is good to laugh. And if you can laugh in labor, great. Your body produces all kinds of beneficial, hormones, but you know, she hired so many people to help her. It's like, don't make this more complicated than it is. It really is a matter of learning how to do nothing. And it's just like when you're growing your baby, you don't have to say, okay, oh, this week we have to grow, you know, a liver and a spleen, and we have to grow fingers and toes. And it's like, this is not a function of the conscious mind. So the same consciousness that is growing your baby knows how to complete the process. And if you don't get in its way, and, you know, basically we have to have that fight flight response. It's designed to save your life. And so it has to override all other bodily functions. So, you know, that's why it will keep you awake when your body really needs sleep, because you're telling it you're in danger. That's why it will keep your baby from coming out. So anyhow, it's just, journaling can be a good thing. Write down, you know, what do I really believe about birth? And allow yourself to kind of just face your fears, and don't criticize yourself for having fear. I also recommend connect with like-minded women, or men, if there are any. You know, there are more women that are interested in this than men, but there are men that are interested. But there, on Facebook, there's a lot of active communities now on Facebook. And I've seen some women join unassisted birth lists or pages, on Facebook, who maybe aren't planning an unassisted birth, but they like being around women that are really, you know, going that route, because they feel like it feels good to be around women that are confident. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, or if you've, so I'd say, yeah, connect with like-minded women. People can write to me. I have a, there's a lot of groups on Facebook. There's probably, oh, at least a dozen groups on Facebook devoted to unassisted childbirth. Now, some of them are private because they want to be able to discuss, you know, they want to discuss things without having someone say, you are insane, or, you know, they want some privacy, but you can become a part of those groups. And, you know, I can connect people with other people that, but there also are many public Facebook groups. There are groups on Yahoo. They aren't quite, now with Facebook, they really aren't that active anymore. There's also unassisted childbirth forums. My forum that I had on my site, and it's called, let's see, bornfree.com. No, that's not it. Bornfreeforum.com. That is still, that's not as active as it once was, here again because of Facebook. But, you know, connect with like-minded women. That can be helpful. And then read books that deal with the power of the mind. That's what I found helpful. The Abraham Hicks material, the Seth material, or if you are spiritual, you know, if you're Christian, these are, you know, whatsoever you believe, that will come to pass. To me, these concepts are, you know, they're in all the major religions. So, but I think here again, people pick and choose. I've seen women who are Christian who will say, you know, well, that's why God gave us doctors. So you know, people who don't want to apply this to their birth, and I'll say, well, what about Christ? You know, Christ was born unassisted. You know, Well, yeah, but God was watching out for Christ, and you know, I need a doctor for my birth. And I think, you know, if you really look at it, why? If you believe, if you have faith, why can't you apply this faith to your birth?
Yeah, good stuff. We're going to take a little break right now, but really, really interesting stuff. And perhaps when we get back, I know there are women out there that are going to be listening to this and that are listening now that have objections, you know, like breached babies and, you know, what if the umbilical cord? These are all stuff that Laura has been able to talk about in the past, and she's got answers for all this stuff. So we'll cover some of that when we get back. And we have a bunch of other stuff too to get to, perhaps like water birthing or standing while you're giving birth, all kinds of cool stuff. So we're with Laura Shanley. Her website, if you're interested, is freebirth.com. This is episode 338 of Extreme Health Radio. So you can check that out at extremehealthradio.com/338. And we'll be right back right after this break. I have to say, I have been absolutely loving this product by Tristan Truscott and Peter Ragnar called Good Morning, Good Evening, Qigong. If you want to listen to the interview we did with Tristan, you can go to extremehealthradio.com/127. And Qigong is a great way to de-stress the body. And as you know, there's a huge component to disease caused by stress. And stress is a huge factor in how we live our lives and the amount of energy we have and the amount of vitality we have. And so, Dr. Shade, what do you think about Qigong?
People come to me and they're really sick and they got this blown out neurological system and all this toxicity. And I tell them, you need to do Qigong, Tai Chi. You need to do these things that settle down and restore your neurology, because it puts together all the parts. It puts you back into that state where you can start to detoxify. And so I highly, highly recommend all that.
And what about you, Kit Campbell? What do you think about Qigong? Do you like it as well?
Qigong is amazing. And the reason that I believe it to be amazing is everything here is energy. That is a scientific fact, if there ever is one. So when you're practicing Qigong, you're actually drawing energy into your body. Your intention, whatever your intention is behind any action, will determine the level of energy, type of energy that you absorb into your body. So your intention behind your is very important, just like thought. So when you're practicing Qigong, you're actually bringing energy in and you're bringing out the stuff that might be a bit stale. With Tai Chi, it's totally different. The energy runs underneath the skin because it's more of a martial, this is the Chinese understanding, by the way. It's more of a martial art. So Qigong is very, very good for bringing that energy into the body, and just fantastic.
If you're interested in picking up this Qigong course by Tristan Truscott and Peter Ragnar, go to extremehealthradio.com/Qigong. That's Qigong. And you can learn more about it. There's a great video on that page, and you can learn more about it on that page. And I highly, highly recommend this product. I love it myself. So go ahead and check that out. extremehealthradio.com/Qigong. So recently we had a really, really great doctor and author on our show, Dr. Doris Rapp, and she was on episode number 56. And she talked about these really great Austin air purifiers and the necessity of having clean air in your house. And she was talking about how inside of our houses, the air is very, very toxic, and it's more toxic than even outside. And the reason is because there's chemicals that are off-gassing from our paints that are in our house, our chemicals and our carpets and the dust and the pollen and the mold and everything else that's inside the air of our house. And we don't get good ventilation. And so having some of these air purifiers are really, really critical. And I spoke with her at length off the air about why she likes these Austin air purifiers and why she promotes them. And it turns out that not only do they get rid of the pollens and the allergens and the dust and the particles and everything that's floating around in your air like most purifiers do, which is great, but they also get rid of, I think, 3,000 different chemicals that are inside. They're just floating around your house. And, you know, these things end up in our lungs and in our bloodstream and all of that kind of stuff. And Doris Rapp has been researching this kind of information for many, many years. I think she's in her 80s now. So she really has a handle on which products are good and which products are not so good. And she recommends the Austin Air. And after talking with her, doing a ton of research on my own, and speaking with a company and looking into it from a lot of different angles, we agree with her. So if you're interested in a good quality air purifier, check it out. You can learn more at extremehealthradio.com/Austin, and you'll be redirected to a website that will sell these things. And they're really, really great machines, and I highly recommend them. If you have a baby, you want to have these things in their room or in the room where you sleep, or you can take them out and put them in your family room. So if you want to listen to that episode, extremehealthradio.com/56 to learn what she says about them, feel free, but we highly recommend them. So it's extremehealthradio.com/Austin, or you could check out our store and learn more about it on there as well. So thanks for listening, and let's get back to the show.
Free shows all the time on Extreme Health Radio. Opening minds and transforming lives worldwide. Join our community today. Sign up to our email list and instantly get our free gift to you, along with loads of inspirational content and cutting-edge tips to help change your life. At extremehealthradio.com/subscribe.
Kate just indulged herself in a little chia seed pudding during the break, didn't you?
I did.
Nothing wrong with that?
It's something that I loved a few months ago and totally forgot about it, and then I've added it back in the last few days. Yum, yum.
What'd you do? Chia seed, a little One More Way, coconut milk.
A little coconut milk and a little vanilla extract.
Ooh, yeah.
Probably not too low on the sugar, but, you know.
Still tastes pretty good, doesn't it?
It's pretty darn good today.
All right, we're having a great time here with Laura Shanley and her website. Again, if you're interested in checking that out, which I highly recommend, it is freebirth.com. And you can also look up her book called Unassisted Childbirth. And we will have links to that on our website here, which is extremehealthradio.com/338. And like the lady said, if you guys want to keep up to date with everything we're doing and have going on, the best way to do that, what I highly recommend, is signing up to our newsletter list. We'll give you an awesome free ebook that sells actually for $20 on Amazon, but we'll send it to you right away just for signing up for free. And it's got a ton of different healing modalities and different protocols for healing, like how to do coffee enemas, how to do castor oil packs, all this great stuff written by John Barron called Lessons from the Miracle Doctors. So I highly recommend signing up and getting that as well. And that way you can also keep up to date with our show. Every week you can find out this past show archives and things. So that's the best way to do it. Like I said, this is episode 338. And Laura, there's a lot of different directions we could go. But, you know, I talked about before the break, maybe talking a little bit about standing while giving birth and water births. But Kate mentioned something that's really interesting during the break about, what was it, hypnobirthing, right?
Yeah,
Kate?
It's quite the trendy kind of buzzword. And we're curious about what that is and what that looks like and if that's a necessary thing or a help for people.
I think hypnobirthing is great. I think in a way I did that. I've never taken a hypnobirthing class. Marie Mongan, who created hypnobirthing, she and I, first made contact in the early 1990s, and she's always been very supportive of my work. I actually just went to, one of the keynote speakers at her hypnobirthing conference in September in Las Vegas, and it was really, my talk was really well received. And she's also one of the few people in the childbirth world who really talks about unassisted childbirth as a, gives that to her students as an option. A lot of people in the alternative birth world, if, you know, they're midwives and doulas, and they're some actually discourage this, and, you know, so, But hypnobirthing you can do, you can have a hypnobirth and have it be unassisted. So I think hypnobirthing practitioners maybe are not as threatened by the unassisted childbirth movement, maybe as some other people are. But hypnobirthing, you basically, Marie and I were both very influenced by Grantley Dickreid. And so hypnobirthing is, you know, quieting the mind and really just trusting the body and allowing it to work the way it was designed. So if you go to my website and there's a video on the main page of a woman giving birth in water, and she's catching the baby herself, and she used hypnobirthing Clio. And so she studied that. So I think, and you won't see a more peaceful birth than that, or a more peaceful baby. Mm. She's just, you know, totally relaxed. So it all gets back to relaxation and whatever can help you get there. So if hypnobirthing appeals to you and you like the idea of having a more structured class, or going to, you know, you can, I think you can do it probably, I guess you can do it online. I probably should know more about it. Online, or listen to the CDs, or take a class. You know, so if that is, if someone is drawn to that, then great. If they're drawn to water birth, wonderful. If a doula is what helps them relax, or a midwife, then great. I think you can, there are some other issues that come up with having, say, a midwife there. But I think that the main thing is, whatever it is that can get you into that place of non-resistance, that's all, you know, that's what it comes down to, just non-resistance. And so, you know, I think the problem sometimes comes when people make, say they, with water birth, you know, oh, if everybody would just give birth in water, that's the answer, you know, or if everybody would just have a doula, or if everyone would have a midwife. And I've seen this, I've seen, you know, the quotes by people who advocate doulas, someday everyone will give birth with a doula, or someday everyone will give birth in water. I just don't believe that. I don't, and nor do I believe that unassisted childbirth is the way to go necessarily. It's, you know, it's what works for you, what can get you into that place of non-resistance. And I think with unassisted childbirth, it's easier because you don't have the interference that generally comes with other, you know, when you have other people there. But so I think, what was your question? How I felt about hypnobirthing?
Yeah.
So I think, yeah, from what I've seen of hypnobirthing, it's saying so many of the same things that I am. But I don't think you necessarily need a method. And I've never promoted a method any more than there's a method of going to the bathroom. You know, it's just, you just let your body work the way it was designed.
Yeah.
And that's sort of the whole thing is it seems like, especially in our culture, just with the recent media, just how the media has sort of exploded with tons of information, tons of different ways for TV shows to come out. And anytime you see someone giving birth on a TV show, it's always in a hospital, it's always in pain. And I can't help but think that maybe that's by design to sort of make the whole birthing process turn into sort of a medical trauma.
Right. I mean, it is usually like the number one or number two reason for going to the hospital in this country. And mm-hmm. so it is a huge business. And, you know, what's unfortunate is that I've seen, you know, even in the midwifery world, that I've seen, you know, oh no, don't go to a doctor, don't go to a hospital, go to a midwife. It's like, you know, I think that we don't need these external authorities. The more we can tap into our own inner knowledge, the less we need to go to any authority in any area of our life. And if we still feel like we need that, and I'm not saying there's never a place for that, but if you feel like you need it, then do it. Mm-hmm. But you know, be honest with yourself and say, yeah, you know, like I have my own fears. I don't have a fear of birth, but I have other issues I've dealt with. Mm-hmm. And I've sought help. You know, I've sought counseling sometimes if I felt like I needed help. And, you know, I still go to a dentist occasionally. You know, so I can see, you know, but to me, like birth is just, it's a natural bodily function. And so when you really grasp that, and you see how easy it can be, then that's why I think the unassisted childbirth movement is growing, because these concepts are just, you know, getting out there in the world, and more people are coming to these same conclusions that, yeah, this is not hard. Mm-hmm. You know, I can do this.
Yeah. And so, you know, a lot of people say, oh, well, you know, if there's ever a time where a woman dies giving birth and she's doing it unassisted, or she's doing it at home with a midwife, it's all over the newspaper. But women, you know, unfortunately die in hospitals and everywhere else too. So it's
right.
It's much, I would say it's probably safer.
I think it's safer. I mean, you know, I've read that every 20 to 30 minutes, a baby is stillborn in an American hospital. And it's just, and I'm not necessarily saying that, that there's, that it's something that a doctor did, you know, but the fact is that you can't say, oh, well, I'm going to give birth in the hospital because I don't want my baby to die. Babies die in hospitals, you know, or maybe they don't die right away, but they may die soon after. Mm-hmm. It's just, you know, one in five pregnancies ends in miscarriage. I mean, death is just a part of life. And so, but I don't believe that what they're doing in the hospital, I don't believe it's based on true science. So much of it is motivated by fear of litigation. That's mm-hmm. just the way it is. You know, if a baby dies, you know, the doctor wants to be able to say, I did everything I could. And unfortunately, there's this idea that if you didn't do a C-section, then you didn't do everything you could. And so, you know, now about 30%, 32% of women who go are having C-sections when mm-hmm. they give birth. And it's major surgery. And, you know, some of them have complications later. There's more hysterectomies. There was a British study that showed that you have a 350% greater chance of needing a hysterectomy later in life by the time if you've had three C-sections. So, I just don't think that hospital, to me, I wouldn't feel comfortable giving birth there. I don't believe personally for me, I feel like in most cases, women are giving birth successfully there in spite of the doctors and nurses, not because of them. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I mean, sometimes a woman needs medical help and I understand that, but mm-hmm. I've heard women say, I just want to go into the hospital. And then if I need them to do anything, I'll ask them. Mm-hmm. And it's like that generally is not the way it goes because they have their every stay, you know, they say, and this is why it can even be problematic with a midwife. Like in Colorado, your water, after 12 hours after your water breaks, you are supposed to be in active labor. And if you're not, that midwife is supposed to tell you to go to the hospital. Mm-hmm. She's really supposed to transfer you to the hospital. And if anything happens, that midwife could lose her license. You know, in some states, midwives are going to jail. And so a midwife really has to choose between, do I do what I think is best and what the mom thinks is best or knows is best, or do I follow what my state government has told me I have to do? And mm-hmm. they have to make that choice, and it puts them in a very difficult position.
And unfortunately, what they do too is they segment everything out, like there's trimesters and there's different stages.
Right.
So if there's certain requirements aren't met during within, you know, a certain trimester of the pregnancy or a few hours of giving birth, you know, you have to act on that. And then, and when in reality, there's no such thing as trimesters or any of that stuff, right?
I never ever once said to somebody, I'm in my third trimester. It's like, okay, I'm pregnant and now I'm not pregnant.
Right,
I never
right.
said I'm in the second stage of labor or, you know, but that's how it's all divided up. And it's like after when your cervix is 10 centimeters dilated and everybody has to be 10 centimeters, regardless of how big you are, how big your baby is, then, you know, if you're not in active labor within an hour of mm-hmm. your cervix being 10 centimeters dilated, they're supposed to transfer you to the hospital. Hmm. And so, and I've heard midwives say, well, we have ways of getting around that. And it's like, yes, it's called lying. So whereas if you live in Oregon, your water could break, your water could be broken for 18 hours or more. And that's fine. In Colorado, that has older laws, that's not fine. And what if a woman's given birth before and she knows that her water breaks and it takes a while? No,
right.
Colorado, you know. So, and I think I once again got way off track, but
it's just interesting how I think that's part of the medicalization of this whole birth thing is how they segment everything in different stages and mm-hmm. times and things. Mm-hmm. What do you think about? Let's see. I had a couple other questions here that I was really interested in. What do you think about ultrasounds?
I don't think they're necessary. They give a lot of false results. Sarah Buckley, who is an MD who writes a lot about home birth, natural birth, has written about that there are people that have done studies that show that they actually can be detrimental. They cause the amniotic fluid to bubble. You know, we don't know what it's doing to babies. And so, it used to be that women were told you should get an x-ray in labor, in pregnancy. And everyone was getting x-rayed. And then eventually they're like, no, x-rays are not good. Well, let's not do that. And so I think maybe someday, that will be the general consensus. But there are already studies that show that this is not a good thing. And I think, studies have shown that it doesn't improve the outcome to do all these ultrasounds. So we're not having better outcomes and healthier moms and babies. And women are told that I used to keep a file, and I don't know what I did with it, but it was of women who had been told that their ultrasound revealed that they their baby, one woman was told her baby was going to be a monster, that your baby is going to have this problem, that problem. And then they ended up having, women who had been counseled to have an abortion, and they ended up having a totally healthy baby. So they give so much information that either is useless or inaccurate. So I think, why do you have to have that picture of your baby in order to connect with your baby? Some people say, the baby didn't really become real to me until I saw the picture on the ultrasound. It's like, well, maybe, tune into your baby in another way. Like, why do we have to see it with our eyes? I think it's exciting to me to not know what you're having until the baby comes out.
Interesting. What do you think about, a lot of women listen to this, maybe not necessarily are going to go completely unassisted, but they want to have a natural birth. And I forget what the actual medical term they've given this, but when a woman has had a C-section and they want to have a natural birth after that.
Oh, a VBAC?
Yeah. VBAC. Yeah. I would do it. I think it would be safer than cutting into the uterus again. So, and I think there's a lot of studies that show that it is better to have a VBAC. But, here again, there's hospital protocol and they have, a lot of doctors don't feel comfortable with it. I just think, every time you cut into something, it's like it weakens it. I don't know. Mm-hmm. But I do think that the uterus is resilient. So I've known women, there are stories out there of women having a vaginal birth after 4, 5, 6. I think there's even one story out there about a woman having a vaginal birth after 7 C-sections.
Oh my gosh.
So I think, it can be done. And the chance of a uterus rupturing in a birth after in a VBAC is pretty low. I don't know exactly what it is, but to me, that's the route I would go if I had a C-section, I would go with a vaginal birth next time.
I hear you. And, I couldn't finish this interview without asking you, or this conversation, I like to call it, without asking you about breached babies. And from what I understand, one of your babies was breached and you still gave birth.
Yeah. That was like, my easiest birth, or along with my last birth, it was, which was so easy. I had, and here is a time when I used dreams. I dreamt during my pregnancy that I was watching a woman giving birth, and she was standing up over this little plastic baby bathtub, and she was catching the baby herself. And I heard a voice say, "Tell her to remember not to do too much." And so I thought, oh, okay. It was a very powerful dream. And so because they didn't have prenatal care, I didn't know that I was carrying a breached baby, but I had decided that I would give birth in this standing position and I would do nothing. I had given birth on my hands and knees with my first baby, so I was planning on doing that with my second until I had the dream. And so when I went into labor with him, I started feeling contractions one morning. We had sex, which can be helpful. You're getting it gets the oxytocin flowing, which I didn't know at that time. But, and then, I was walking across the room, my water broke, and that was about 2 hours after my first contraction, and I took out my little plastic baby bathtub, and at this point, I didn't feel anything. I was not in pain. I felt nothing. I reached my hand up inside myself, and I felt the muscles contracting, but I was not feeling any pain, and I did have pain with my other, I had some pain mm-hmm. with my other labors. It was never excruciating, or, you know, I never was, like, screaming or anything, but, so I just stood over the little bathtub, and then a foot came out. And so, and my husband said, you know, what should we do? Should we go to the hospital? And I'm like, we go to the hospital. They're cutting me open. I do not feel comfortable putting myself in their hands. There's actually a person in Boulder in a wheelchair because they were coming out feet first, and the doctor pushed on their feet, on the baby's foot. And and they were paralyzed for life. So now, generally, they're not going to push on the foot. They're not going to even let you go into labor because if they know it's a breech birth. But I just did nothing, and then his other foot popped out, and I just stood there. And we said belief suggestions that we had inner help, and everything's fine. And then when the time felt right, I gave one sort of push pull. And just kind of guided him out. And that was 2 hours after my first contraction. So I think so much of the time with breech birth, it's people panic. So, of course, if you're panicking, you're shutting off the flow of birth hormones and shutting and turning on the stress hormones that shut down labor.
And from what I understand, too, the baby is working in rhythm. The baby wants to be birthed, and the baby wants to be able to communicate with the woman. And so right. when you start, I guess, communicating and sort of trusting in the process, you work symbiotically. Is that correct?
Right. I mean, I think that is the baby wants to be born. And so in most cases, now there are babies, I think if you've been telling your baby throughout your pregnancy, it's dangerous out here, which I did have a dream once that I was in the womb and I could hear my parents saying, you know, it's dangerous out here. I think some babies may not want to come out, but if you can reassure them that this is a good world, they're loved, they're wanted, you know. This is a joint effort between the mother and the baby. And so, and I had a dream after my son Willie was born, the breech baby, that he was saying that birth had gone so well because he wasn't afraid on his side. Mm. And so he wanted to come out. I wanted him to come out. And it was just so smooth and easy. And wow. I think that's how it can be.
That's so cool. Do you have any dietary suggestions for women during pregnancy, things they should avoid or types of foods that maybe they should?
That's a good question.
Yeah. To include?
This is where some people get mad at me, and I've actually had people write me letters.
Oh, no.
Because I actually tell people, eat whatever you want. And I am not really – I believe in what it says – in both the Abraham and the Seth material, that what we believe about what we eat is more important than what we eat. Mm. I'm not saying go out and eat potato chips all day long. I do think it's better to eat more natural foods, but I think people put too much, they give food too much power. And I think if you can just, if you feel like eating something, eat it. If you really are, so many people eat because they're stressed, they're afraid, they're overeating because they're afraid. Mm-hmm. And actually eating does help minimize the adrenaline. And so it does calm you down, you know, but if you really are not afraid, you shouldn't be overeating. If you have a craving for something sweet, go for it. I don't know. I have an article on my site, I think it's still there. It may be one that I haven't put back up. Mm-hmm. But it's eating during pregnancy. Indulge yourself. You know, I've seen women just beat themselves up over eating a cookie. And I think, you know, I ate whatever I wanted. And I put in my book that I ate M&Ms. And I met somebody once, and when I said something about my book, she's like, I read your book. She's like, oh, yeah, you're the woman who ate M&Ms. Like, from everything in my book, that was the one thing that she took away from my book.
Isn't that funny?
You know, it's like, I don't think that everything in moderation. If you feel like having something sweet, have it. I don't know. I ate whatever I wanted, and I did fine.
What do you think about lotus births? Because that's a big thing, and people eating the placenta, and I guess those are two separate things, but yeah. And cutting the cord and all that.
You know, lotus birth is not something I ever felt drawn to. I know some women really like it. And lotus birth, for those people that don't know, it's you never cut the cord. So when the baby is born, you know, after the placenta comes out, you wrap up the placenta. You can put, I think there's ways of salting it or putting herbs or something, and you keep the placenta near the baby until the cord naturally detaches within a few days. Mm-hmm. I never personally was drawn to it. I personally feel, you know, most animals will chew through the cord. I feel that the placenta did its job. Thank you very much. I'm letting you go. Mm-hmm. The downside of it to me is that I've seen some women get so concerned with this entity that is the placenta, you know, keeping it. I mean, it can be very messy. It doesn't have to be, but it can be messy and bloody, and mm-hmm. they're so consumed with keeping this placenta, you know, wrapped and close to the baby that it kind of can limit your movement. I know that women who are for lotus birth will tell me that, you know, they, it doesn't have to be that way. It just was personally something that I felt okay about cutting the cord. I did cut it. I did wait until it had stopped pulsating. I do think it's good to wait because the blood is still, after the baby's born, blood is still going through the cord. So I do think it's good. There's no rush at all on cutting that cord. And so, you know, but I don't think you need to wait a few days. That's just me personally. Mm-hmm. So if you're drawn to lotus birth, do it. I never ate the placenta. Here again, some women say, well, it can help with hemorrhage, and maybe it can. I think if you are truly relaxed, you are producing estrogen and oxytocin, which helps the cervix to close, and so you shouldn't really hemorrhage if you really are calm. You know, I think hemorrhaging is just another one of these things. When you're panicking, you're not producing the birth hormones that will naturally complete the birth. So I always look at a more kind of psychological angle. And so I never felt compelled to eat the placenta, but if people feel like they want to eat it, then do it.
Very fascinating. To kind of wrap up the show, I was just curious about different labor times. Did you have a wide variance of labor times with your four children?
Yeah. Most of my labors were short. And the exception was my daughter, Joy. And I went into labor with her one morning, and she wasn't born until the following morning. So I probably was in labor for 24 hours. Mm-hmm. I was going through a stressful time. I feel like I just was keeping her from coming out, and my husband and I were fighting. She was posterior, meaning she was facing my front rather than facing my back. Mm-hmm. So when she came out, I birthed her into my hands and she was looking at me, and which was totally cool. And the water bag broke over her face. So when I first saw her, I could see her through the water bag.
Wow.
And, but yeah, so, you know, the other one, I mean, the shortest was probably 2 hours. My last one was probably 2 hours. So yeah, anywhere from 2 hours to 24 hours. I think if you're in labor for a few days, I'd say you probably have some mental blocks. I think that the body kind of wants to get the baby out quickly. And so I think if you're in labor for a few days, that doesn't necessarily mean go rush off to the hospital. To me, it means look at your, you know, what's going on with you mentally, mm-hmm. emotionally. But, you know, and same with like the placenta. I'm coming out with a new edition of my book, because if people go to my website and they see my book, it's like a $35 book. It was published by an academic press. Within the next month or two, I finally got the paperback rights to my book. And so I'm coming out with a paperback that'll be about $16. And if people want to write to me I can put them on a list and they'll be notified. If they go to my website, they click on the contact and write to me. But in my book, I have a story from a woman whose placenta came out 36 hours after the birth. Someone wrote to me once and said, you know, announcing the birth of my baby, the placenta came out 3 days later. We buried it under a tree. I think there's the placenta having to come out immediately is another one of these things. I'll mm-hmm. just briefly say, same with cord around the neck, happens about 25 to 30% of the time. It happened with my last birth. I unwound it. It doesn't have to be an emergency. Mm-hmm. Blood and oxygen are still generally going through the cord. But so, and what was your question?
No, just about the differences in labor times.
It varies.
Yeah, I'm sure. And like you said, I mean, it happens 25% of the time and with the cord wrapping around the neck. And, you know, it's a natural thing. It doesn't have to be an emergency.
Right. It's just, here again, don't panic. It can be unwound. Someone wrote to me and said they had 7 babies, you know, not all at once. And each time the cord was around the neck, once it was around the neck 3 times and other times 4 times, each time they unwound it and they did fine. So it's, I'm not saying it's never problematic, but I'd say it's rarely problematic and it's more, very common.
Well, it's amazing because you kind of made that joke about the 7 babies, but what came to mind was that woman who gave birth to 8 babies.
Oh, the octomom.
The octomom. And I figure if a woman can give birth to 8, you know, surely the body can do 1, you know?
Right. Yeah.
Good point.
Wow. So you have, do you have any other projects going on, but you're going to be re-releasing your paperback version of your book and...
Yeah,
that's
right
exciting.
Now there's also an expensive 1994 paperback that my publisher put out. But this one will be reasonably priced. I wanted work on my side. I'm going to be teaching a class through a place called Entheos Academy, and I'll have information on that on my site. I do one-on-one counseling with women to help them overcome fear. Basically, I tell people, you know, you don't need me. You don't even need my book or my website. As much as I enjoy making money off of my birth work, you know, you have the knowledge within yourself. But if you want a little help, I do one-on-one phone counseling or Skype counseling. And so their information about that is available on my site. I speak when asked, which is not very often, because here again, you know, our midwife's going to come have me speak.
Nope.
You know, it's just the birth world of doctors. They don't really want to come have me speak. And midwives have sometimes told me, you know, if everybody does it this way, I'll be out of a job. Although there are midwives that are supportive of me. And I've spoken at Carla Hartley's Trust Birth conferences. Trustbirth.com is a website that promotes all sorts of birth. I've spoken at conferences put on by Jenny Hatch and Lynn Griesmer. Lynn Griesmer wrote Unassisted Home Birth, An Act of Love, and her site is unassistedhomebirth.com. And so they both had me speak. So I do interviews when asked, and so those are the kinds of things I have going right now.
That's so awesome. So you'll do one-on-one Skype consultations with women who are looking to sort of overcome some of their own fears and things. What a cool thing.
Right. And sometimes their partners get on the phone too, and so, or their moms, you know, are freaking out. Because I think that's probably the biggest challenge to having an unassisted birth is dealing with a culture that doesn't support it.
Mm-hmm.
And so you have to make the decision that you just don't care what anybody else thinks, and you're going to do what feels right to you.
I love that. And, you know, your approach is very similar to ours because, you know, doing the type of work that we do, we have to make a return. We have to be able to support ourselves. And I tell people all the time that a lot of the products that are in our store, people, you know, they help, I guess, speed along the process of becoming healthier and, you know, rebounding and sweating and things like this. But ultimately, you know, people don't need any of the products that are on our store to be healthy. Or people, same with what you were saying, you know, people can do all this by themselves, you know?
Right.
Yeah, it's just refreshing. So, well, thank you so much, Laura, for being on the show. I love your work so much. And
great conversation.
Yeah.
Yeah, I enjoyed it.
Anything we can do to help you, please let us know.
Okay, great.
Okay.
Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Laura. So hang on the line there. We're going to close out our live show for all the live listeners. We appreciate you guys so much. Isby joined the chat room. That was fun. And
nice.
Colin was in there.
Thanks.
Colin had to leave, but a lot of great people in the chat room today. So thank you all for joining us and we appreciate it so much. This was episode 338 and Laura's website can be found at freebirth.com. And she mentioned a ton of different websites and books and things. And Kate was so nice to take notes of all of that, right?
I've got most or all of them, so they'll be up later.
So cool. So we're going to put all and link up everything in the show notes at extremehealthradio.com/338. And Kate and I are going to be back in just a moment talking about this show. So thank you all for joining us live and we'll be back on Friday at 9 a.m. Pacific.
And we'll catch you guys on the next episode.
Okay, wonderful.
Awesome. Thanks, Laura.
Have a great day.
Okay, you too.
Thanks.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye. All right, that was an awesome show, wasn't it?
Oh, my goodness. That's the first, I think it's the first interview we've had just solely focusing on birth, isn't it?
We had one back a while ago about the dangers of hospital births with Janice Barcelo.
Oh.
That was really, really good.
Was I on that?
You weren't on that, no.
I didn't think so.
That was a very fearful sort of show. I mean, it was really eye-opening. So I think it's important information. But
that one focused more on the opposite spectrum of what could go wrong?
The dangers of hospital births.
Gotcha.
More, so. Mm-hmm. But yeah, we've got a lot to decode and a lot to talk about after this particular interview. So this is going to be good. All right, stay tuned. We're going to run a little bit of a break here and we'll be right back. And Kate and I are going to have a little discussion about what we talked about today.
Nice.
Okay, one sec. Hey guys, if you've been following our work for any length of time, you know that I'm a big fan of raw food. I did a raw food diet actually from 2003 to 2010, 100%, and I loved it. And raw food is a huge part of my diet and I just love it. And if you're interested in making healthy, really amazing raw food dishes without spending hours and hours in the kitchen, I would highly recommend checking out a program put together by Russell James called the Raw Chef Program. You could check it out at extremehealthradio.com/raw chef. And I have to say, it's absolutely incredible. I have it and it's got hundreds of hours of video, professionally done video along with workbooks and PDF files. And he walks you through how to make the most amazing, delicious raw food meals that don't take forever. Everything from mock pizzas and pasta to ice cream to cheese to fluffy bread, if you can imagine it. It's incredible. So I highly recommend you checking it out. It's you can check it out at extremehealthradio.com/rawchef. And I think you are absolutely going to love this program. So check it out now.
All three shows all the time on Extreme Health Radio. Opening minds and transforming lives worldwide. Join our community today. Sign up to our email list and instantly get our free gift to you, along with loads of inspirational content and cutting edge tips to help change your life at extremehealthradio.com/subscribe.
Well, that was quite the informative show. I was just a little bit late getting back to this because I was busy typing in the chat room. People are still talking in there about everything that was going on.
To head back in there.
Pretty cool, huh?
Yeah.
Hey, so what did you think about her saying you should just eat anything you want during pregnancy? That was pretty interesting.
That was, it was, wasn't it?
Yeah, right?
Gosh, I just feel like the information we get on the show, everybody has such different opinions and... I agree. I personally agree that I do agree with the statement she said about what you think about the food and your emotional state around it is more important than the actual our relationship with food. You know,
oh my gosh,
it's the health, the healthy mindset of our food more than what kind of foods we're actually putting in. That I totally agree with that.
Yeah, I feel like we've been learning that more and more. That's been beat into our heads over the past year and a half,
mm-hmm.
more so than anything else. I mean, obviously there's foods that you want to avoid and foods you want to eat, but man, your perception of what you eat and what you, and how you think about what you eat is 100 times more important than what you're eating.
I think so.
That was pretty interesting, huh?
It was. And I can see why. I mean, when she was leading up to that, she said she'll get a lot of emails or letters written to her,
right.
You know, in regards to that statement. But people get freaked out about that. And, you know, but who's to say? I mean, I think when you're healthy overall in your mind, your body is going to react differently than when you're eating from a place of fear. I mean, it just...
Or eating while you're stressed.
Or eating while any of that.
You know, I thought it was really interesting what she was saying about... I wonder if there's a connection between women who have long labors or women who have children that are breached or women that have difficulty giving birth.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder if there's a connection between maybe the language they're using when they're pregnant, how stressed they are, because it makes so much sense that if a child is in the womb and they're sort of taught by subconscious programming, it's a dangerous world. It's a fearful world. It's a world that
not safe to come into.
It's not safe. You have to feel like you watch your back, and it's a scary place. I mean, it makes total sense that they wouldn't want to come out. Why would anyone want to? You know, if we're in a room here and outside that door is a war zone, you know, why would I want to stay or, you know, go into that war zone when I'm safe inside here?
Well, you know what? You could take it to a level deeper too, which might be a little bit frightening. But when you think about it, what about the women who sit there pregnant watching the news every night?
Oh, God.
I mean, who knows what the baby's hearing, what the baby's gathering, and then the woman's just like full brain waves are changing as they're watching these horrific things that are reported every day. I mean,
shootings.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
Stresses about, you know, droughts and water shortages and shootings in your neighborhood, accidents on the freeway, children being struck and killed on Halloween. I mean, there's all these things that happen.
Well, we were talking yesterday about how, you know, just watching the news, even if you don't feel stressed, like, you know how we were in Palm Springs a while back and we don't have a TV. We don't own, you know, cable. So we don't watch the news. Remember when we were watching the news, just could not believe the level of fear. And I was watching it because they were doing this whole thing on Ebola. Remember they had that guy in the apartment complex, some guy, who knows if he was a real guy, but he was in this hazmat suit and the whole thing was trying to generate fear. But I didn't feel any fear at all, right?
Yeah,
because
I didn't either.
I know it's a whole, it's a production, this whole, I don't know, this whole
whether
production.
It's true or not, it's being blown out of proportion, I think, too.
Yeah.
Really big.
But I wonder, even if you've done a lot of sort of spiritual work or you're able to hold your ground and protect your inner space well, even just watching the news, even if you don't feel like a thing in your gut, if you're pregnant and you're just watching the news, and you feel like, oh, that doesn't affect me. I'm not emotionally charged by that. I wonder if it's still, I'm sure it's still affecting because the baby hasn't done that work, right? So the baby would get
it.
So even if the woman is completely calm, but those noises are coming through, I don't know.
Suspect if you're hearing sirens or if you're, you know, hearing people in panicked voices or, yeah, I don't know, just sad words being said or fearful words being repeated. Oh, I think there's so much to this. I am, unfortunately, it makes me feel like I'm nowhere near the place I want to be when we have a baby.
Well, yeah. But,
that's how I feel, though. Like,
you know, but yeah, I think that whatever decision you choose to make, you know, we're all on a journey to become more free. And there's no right or wrong in terms of that, you know, whatever direction we decide to go, it's going to be the direction that was necessary. And, regardless, I mean, look at the sort of medicalized births that you and I had and we're doing pretty good.
No, yeah. We've had to unravel a lot of stuff though. Yeah. I wish I would have known this stuff and been aware of it at 20 so that I would have had, you know, 16 years to work on this stuff.
Imagine
how much farther you'd be.
Yeah.
But I guess anyone would say that looking back in their life, but.
It's interesting how they do medicalize the birth process. When you see a birth on TV shows or movies, it's always a woman screaming in pain. And I was going to mention this to Laura. They should rename labor, shouldn't they?
Labor.
I mean, it's kind of a weird thing. Like her labor was, I think it was something that was pleasurable.
It didn't sound like it was half bad, did it?
So, I mean, labor just imbues within it, carries with it so many hidden messages within that word labor.
Laborious, hard work.
Yeah.
Which, and, I mean, it is your body working. It's involuntarily even working. It's going to do it no matter what to help get the baby out.
But the cool thing is that the baby's working too.
Right.
So it's like if I have a 50-pound weight to pick up and I have someone's help, then I only have to pick up 25 pounds of that.
Yeah, you're right.
So when the baby, when you're in harmony with the baby, baby wants to get out too.
Yeah, you're right.
Assuming it's a safe world. And
what would you rename it to?
Labor. Because think of it, labor camps.
Oh.
You know, labor camps, something like the Nazi labor camps.
Wow.
I mean, I don't know. What do you rename it to? Labor. I have to get creative.
Huh, you would have to. Yeah.
I'll have to think about that one.
Huh.
Yeah.
Interesting.
What do you think about the lotus birth?
I don't know. Jury's still out with that one for me. Yeah.
That doesn't... Well, the lotus birth, but the eating of the placenta does not gross me out if you do it in pill form and powder.
Yeah, that wouldn't gross me out that way, but if I... Yeah. I don't think I'd really want to spend much time with it, like seeing it, or yeah. I would take the pills, no problem, powder it up.
You know, they have these lotus birthing little baskets for the placenta. Have you heard about those?
I have. I don't quite understand. So the baby is in one little basket and the placenta is in another? Or are they both in this? It fits both the baby and the placenta into a basket.
No, I think the placenta is in the basket and the baby's connected to it with the cord. And the basket's able to breathe. So it's not, it's drying out naturally kind of thing. But you have to, if you move the baby around from room to room, you have to carry the basket. So it's a bit of a pain.
Would you do that? Is that something that interests you or do you think it's really necessary?
I don't really know. I don't think it's like one of those things where I see the benefit of eating the placenta. If you were to dry it out and powder it down and put it in capsule form, I could see that there could be an argument made for that. I can see there's an argument that could be made for women who don't want to cut the cord because you get those stem cells and those incredible immune system cells that come from the placenta mm-hmm. for. I don't know what it is at 5 minutes or so after the birth or 10 minutes where it pulses and you're getting that rich blood. So I can see not cutting the cord. After that, I don't think that it's that I would be that. I think I'd be good either way. If that were something that you felt strongly about and wanted to do, I'd be totally cool with it. Cause it's almost like, can I have too many green juices in a day? Mm. It's like, they're so incredible.
Right.
I mean, maybe you can make an argument for too many green juices, but, it just seems like if you're doing that, it's not going to do any harm other right. than just having to lug it around.
Now that seems laborious.
Put it in your purse and carry it around.
Oh, God. Can you imagine? Well,
yeah.
In your purse.
Yeah, I like what she's doing with the women in fear, though. I think
yeah.
that's...
Well, I think that's the part that just, I resonate with that. I'm sure a lot of women do. I mean, just this, it's funny that that's not her fearful thing. I mean,
yeah, isn't that weird?
I'm jealous of that because that's a big fear of mine and has been. I shouldn't say is, but I'm working through that. I'd say
was.
Still is, but yeah. I'm working through it.
Yeah.
But yeah, my gosh, like this is something I never would have considered even 5 years ago. So yeah. It's just really neat to see, even when you just start working on yourself without hearing about all these factors about birthing and stuff, I think that you're just more open to things in general.
Mm-hmm.
And you kind of want to go back to maybe the roots of the women who have, gone before you and done mm-hmm. this. I mean, our yeah. bodies are made to do such an amazing work that if we just get out of our own way. But I think that on a spiritual level, you have to really come to a place where you can do that. Getting out of your own way is a really big thing.
I think for me, it's incredibly important for women to take years of their life before giving birth, maybe for the first time. But I think it's really important to understand the power of what that is and what's happening. I think it's really important for women to understand that this isn't some little thing that's happening here.
Yeah.
And it's such a process that's been medicalized and been driven. The fear has been just driven into women that you have to go to a hospital in order to do this. And I think that if you want to have any shot, I think that it would be really, really helpful for women to start working on themselves for as long as they possibly can in order to get to the point where when they're giving birth, they're trusting. Like your hips and women's hips are built.
Mm-hmm.
for this
mm-hmm.
and it's important to realize that I was made for this and I think a lot of women just say I'll go to a hospital and have them take care of everything and there could be problems with that.
I think no matter what, because there's no guarantee a person could even make it to a hospital. A lot of people have these random things happen where they wake up and all of a sudden they're in labor and they're not going to a hospital. So mm-hmm. I think the thing is it's like the daily affirmations that people do to just get in a better place spiritually, mental, emotionally every day, just on a dealing with life basis,
mm-hmm.
being able to go into that being able to go inward and find that still place and find a place of peace and learn to regulate your breathing and just that on a daily basis is really important. Mm-hmm. And I think like when we were talking about the hypnobirth, when she said that, that's kind of what she did without giving it a name. Isn't that what we should all be doing anyway? I mean,
even if there was no birth.
Yeah, even if there was no birth. So mm-hmm. I'm thinking, yeah, I mean, women who don't technically, quote, train with a hypnobirth person. I mean, you're right. I think you can do that when you are pregnant, though. Just, you know, visualize and dream and go into those states of what it's going to be like and really affirm yourself and, you know, train your brain in a way that's your own hypnotic state that you could be able to get into the snap of a finger. Just go to that place because it's so comfortable. You've done it the whole pregnancy that, you know, what's going to be the difference other than maybe some bit of pain associated with it, but that you could work through it, hopefully. I don't know. I mean,
I think that's a really good idea because a lot of women do the whole birthing classes and how to breathe and the Bradley method. Maybe we'll put a link for that, and learn how to breathe and all this stuff during the time of pregnancy. But, you know, we should be learning how to breathe and getting into a hypnotic meditative state every single day in order to de-stress and all that. I think it's incredibly important. So if you're able to do that as a practice, as a woman, on a regular basis, and you do it every single day, then when it comes time to give birth, I mean, think how easy it's going to be. It's like going to be, you know, as easy as Kobe Bryant shooting a free throw or Michael Jordan. You can shoot with your eyes closed because that muscle memory is just there. Mm-hmm. You can snap into that state anytime you want.
Yep.
Last night, it was interesting when I was putting together the show notes for this page, I was looking around and, one of our companies that we work with, Less EMF, has a really cool baby belly band. Have you seen that?
Oh, you showed that to me this morning.
Yeah, it's cool. It's this EMF protecting belly band that you can wear over your stomach as a woman while you're pregnant to prevent electromagnetic field radiation from getting into your belly. Because I see women, you've seen it.
Oh, yeah.
With their cell phones right on their stomach.
Oh, right on their tummies. Well, I find it really interesting because, you know, those belly bands are really, most pregnant women wear them at some point anyway. Mm-hmm. So why would you not go the extra step and protect yourself from what's going through your belly?
Yeah.
Not just holding your belly in the right place and making it more comfortable, but actually protecting the things passing right through into that baby's brain, into the whole system. I mean, I didn't even know that existed. They look like a really cool product, don't they?
I know, it's cool. If you want to
Be getting one.
If you want to go through our link to get that, that would support us. And I think that would probably be really, really something to think about if you're pregnant. It's extremehealthradio.com/lessEMF. And I'll put links to that on this show page. But
yeah, that was a good find.
Yeah, that was really cool.
Mm-hmm.
I heard about Laura Shanley. I think it was from the Conscious Parenting Summit from Matt Monarch and Angela Stokes?
I think it was.
Yeah, the Conscious Parenting Summit.
I think we've heard her before.
We'll put a link to that too. Talk about really great information.
Oh my gosh. That was stuff I'd never dream of hearing, to be honest.
The Dunstan baby language and all kinds of stuff.
Oh, it's good.
Pretty cool stuff. Yeah, I would highly recommend if you guys are interested in this type of information, that is the best resource.
Out there, I think
for all kinds of really great interviews. Also, we promote a really awesome product by, what is his name? Chris Kresser, called the Healthy Baby Code. And that talks about diet and nutrition and all kinds of really great stuff too, about pregnancy and birthing. But yeah, I'm just a fan of that. I'm a fan because, you know, I remember David Wolf talking to him one time about his written stated goal for how long he wants to live. And have you heard how long he wants to live?
Isn't it like 300 and something?
3,000 years.
Oh, three. I was off. I was way off.
Yeah. So he was like, you know, people make fun of him for wanting to live for 3,000 years. And he said, well, I got a lot of work to do. So I need all 3,000 years. And he said, you know what? If I shoot for Pluto and I make it to the moon, then I'm happy. So if he lives for 150, 200 years and his goal was 3,000, then most people die at 75. So he's doing pretty good.
Wow.
So with this kind of thing, maybe the home run, the grand slam is unassisted home childbirth for you or for someone else listening. They think that's the best thing. But if you prepare for something like that and you end up giving birth in a hospital with a doula and a midwife, you know, that's awesome.
That's awesome.
That potentially that could have been better for you than doing the full C-section thing in a hospital.
It's true.
And another thing that women don't know about, or a lot of women don't know about, is when you give C-sections, the baby doesn't get that healthy dose of its first inoculation for an immune system.
Yep. They get a big slurpy couple I don't know, mouthfuls of that bacteria that they're not going to get when they come out the vaginal way.
Yeah. So really interesting stuff, huh?
I wonder too, I've heard that, I'm not sure if this is true, but I've heard about C-sections, saying that you don't get the colostrum coming through when you take the baby C-section wise. Is that true?
You mean for when they breastfeed?
When they first breastfeed? Do you not produce that?
Oh, wow.
I could be making that up, but I thought I've heard that before. And I thought that was one of the reasons why it's so unbeneficial to have a C-section beside the fact you go through major surgery and stuff.
Oh, you mean not beneficial to have a C-section?
Not beneficial. Sorry.
Yeah.
Not beneficial.
Wow. No, I've never heard of that. I'd have to look into that.
Okay.
I wonder if that's true. Yeah, interesting.
Yeah. Either way, it's not ideal. It's not what our bodies were. I mean, like she was saying, the less you can cut into somebody, the better. It baffles me that women sign up for these, you know, scheduled C-sections and births. And
isn't that amazing?
To go along with their schedule and that doctors have no problem doing it. It's just...
Or sometimes doctors will sort of put the pressure on for that because they've got a golf tournament to get to.
Mm-hmm.
Or they got to go to Hawaii for a
family vacation. No, you're right.
A family
Make
vacation.
Their kid's birthday party. I mean, it's you hear it all.
Nuts, isn't it?
Yep.
Wow. So this was a really interesting interview, and there's lots of great books that she mentioned and lots of great... information websites and all kinds of really cool people that you mentioned. So we'll link everything up. Thank you, Kay, for doing that.
You are very welcome.
That's awesome.
I really enjoyed that.
So if you were listening to that while you're running or doing, you know, driving around, doing errands, you didn't have to take any notes at all. Kate was able to do that for you, and everything will be linked up at extremehealthradio.com/338, along with the commercials that we ran and all that stuff. And if you guys could do us a huge favor, it would help us tremendously if you would head on over to iTunes as soon as you can so that you don't forget. If you're out listening to this while you're driving or something like that, the next time you can go back to your computer.
Or if you're birthing a baby.
If you're birthing a baby.
We can wait till after that.
if you're middle
we can
of
wait.
Birth,
we'll give you a hall pass for that one.
If you go to iTunes Store and you log in and then you search for Extreme Health Radio, all one word, you'll find our podcast. And if you could actually leave us a review and a rating, subscribe to us there. That would be really, really helpful. So we'd appreciate that. And another way to support us too is, like I said at the beginning of the show, going through our link when you go to Amazon. So if you go to Amazon on a regular basis, you can always bookmark our link and use that same bookmark every single time. And that's a great way to keep us free. But we do accept donations humbly, and we're so grateful for those. If you ever want to send us a donation, and we have our store where we talked about today, the Bellicon Rebounder, the Austin Air Purifier, the Morocco Method, the Raw Chef, and the One World Whey Protein Powder. So all that stuff is in our store as well. So if you want to check out some great products that we're going to be adding to on a regular basis, check that out. So, all right. So that's about it, right?
That's a wrap.
And we're not going to have another show till Friday.
Yeah.
It's going
to
be...
Welcome to the new schedule.
Welcome to the new schedule.
Yeah.
Welcome to the jungle.
Welcome to the jungle.
As Axl Rose would say.
Nice.
So thank you everybody for joining us. Please pass this show on to your friends or share it in any groups or forums that you are a part of, and let people know about Laura Shanley's work. We would appreciate that, and that would be so helpful. So thank you all so much, and...
I get to say it again?
Get to say it again.
We'll catch you guys and gals and pups.
And pups.
Furry babies on the next episode.
Hey, everybody. This is Josie, Justin's mom. Don't tell him, but I know he would absolutely be really happy if you would sign up to his free weekly newsletter. And don't forget to share this with all your friends. This is the buzzing bumblebee signing off.
That was so good.
That's where we get the follow.
Oh my gosh.
Thank you for listening to this episode.
It's time to go for now, but our mission does not end with this show.
Justin and Kate will be back with another interview packed full of ideas, discoveries, and unique ways to regain your health.
Head on over to extremehealthradio.com/subscribe and instantly download our free gift too that contains cutting-edge strategies to start making healthy lifestyle changes today.
No material on this blog is intended to suggest that you should not seek professional medical care. Always work with qualified medical professionals, even if you educate yourself in the field of live food, nutrition, and alternative medicine. I'm not a doctor, nor am I offering readers medical advice of any kind. None of the information